you've officially made it to late July, a month in which we lit off fireworks and then we lit a couple of rockets and put two billionaires in space. What a month. So glad that you're tuning in this week into this teaching video, and I also hope you're planning on attending one of our local branches this Sunday. You know, branches, if you don't know what those are, they're just smaller gatherings. They're expressions of the church where we worship together and we hang out and we talk about the things that matter most, namely the work of God in our lives. And so I can't stress enough how important we believe it is for you to stay connected to one another as we grow together and as we walk forward in mission and in vision, all for the sake of Christ and His kingdom. So if you're not yet connected, go to our website, or simply you can use the link at the bottom of the screen, and we will see you there. All right, so super stoked for where we're going and what we're going to be diving into for the rest of the summer, because today we are launching a brand new teaching series that's going to take us through August. And this series, it's going to have plenty of surprises and opportunities and fun and just plain goodness. That's all going to be unveiled next Sunday in our larger in-person gathering on the corner of Arrow Highway and Bonnie Cove. You know, we just spent a little over 6 months immersing ourselves in Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, this subversive, prophetic call to live an alternative way and to form alternative kinds of communities. And as we embody Jesus' life and teachings, we call this the way of Jesus, or life in the kingdom of God. And we ended last week with Jesus concluding this sermon, and the crowd goes wild. It literally says that they were amazed at his teaching because he taught as one who had authority. And what gave it such authority? You know, Eugene Peterson, he so wonderfully gives us a window into this whole scene when he puts it this way. He says, the crowd burst into applause because it was apparent that he was living everything he was saying. I mean, that's what amazes the masses. That's where real authority comes from. And that, my friends, that's our call as his followers. So may it be so with us, that our community would be amazed, and that our authority as a church, or our influence in the world, would come from one thing and one thing only: a group of people who are actually living everything he was saying. A group of people who have embraced and who have embodied this alternative kingdom, which by very nature, it's going to raise some questions. And so for the next 6 weeks, we're going to talk about how do we foster, how do we nurture this kind of alternative Christian lifestyle, and how do we become this kind of church? A lifestyle, yeah, it's going to raise some eyebrows, provoke curiosity and questions about what this is all about, which is why we're calling this series Living Questionable Lives. Now, when we talk about questionable living, we're talking about this in the most redemptive Jesus way possible. Because if you read through the Gospels, you know that Jesus was often questioned about why he said or why he did certain things. And in Mark chapter 2, Jesus gets absolutely blitzed over and over again by the same question that if I'm honest, often blitzes me from my 7-year-old. It's that infamous why question. Do you know this one? So Mark, which is like the shortest gospel, but the action and the dialogue, man, it comes fast and furious. And in chapter 2, it opens with Jesus healing a paralyzed man in a house that's long since given up social distancing. But before healing the man, Jesus says to him, "Son, your sins are forgiven," which drives the teachers of the law bonkers. And it causes them to ask in verse 7, "Why does this fellow talk like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" I mean, bestowing forgiveness on a sinner? This is highly questionable, albeit highly redemptive behavior. Now, the very next scene in Mark, it's this scene that has Jesus calling the tax collector Levi to follow him. And then he's having a meal at his house with, it says, many other tax collectors and sinners. And once again, this triggers the religious leaders, who begin to scroll through their scrolls for a chapter and a verse that forbids this kind of questionable behavior from a Jewish rabbi. And again, they ask the exact same question in verse 16. They say, why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners? So first it's forgiveness, and now it's acceptance and fellowship. Again, thoroughly questionable. There's actually one more why question interaction in Mark, but I think you get the point. I mean, Jesus was different. Jesus was eccentric. Jesus lived questionably. His life evoked a curiosity and questions that, yeah, it challenged the status quo. And while some were skeptical and some called him a radical and a lunatic, a troublemaker, others were amazed and intrigued and compelled because this is what they'd been searching for their whole lives. You could say it this way. Jesus lived a why kind of way. And he calls his followers to do the same. You see, from the very beginning, it's always been this different way of living as a community of faith that's been what has evoked questions from the dominant culture and what has intrigued others to follow. Peter, you know, one of Jesus' first followers, a leader in the early church in Acts, he writes a couple letters later in the New Testament. And in his first letter, in 1 Peter, he writes this in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 15. He writes, "Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you, to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect." You know, you typically only give answers if people are doing what? Asking questions, right? And people are only going to ask you and I questions about the hope that we have in Jesus if they see what? Catchy bumper sticker or a poignant sign? A cool program or facility? No, maybe it's if they see or hear something different. Something intriguing, something compelling, something redemptive that's bringing real healing to the world. Something that would cause them to ask, why? You know, for the first Christians, this approach, it was literally transforming the Roman Empire. Because you had hundreds, if not thousands, of ordinary followers of Jesus who had infiltrated every part of society by living questionable lives that were evoking curiosity. And because of this, even at the highest levels, the influence of Christians could not be denied. And so in the 4th century, you had the emperor Julian, who actually feared that the followers of Jesus might take over the Roman Empire. But it wasn't because they had finally achieved a level of political or military power. Get this. It was because they were living out the Sermon on the Mount together. They were caring for the poor and feeding the hungry. They were loving their enemies and forgiving their persecutors, which were the Romans. They were sacrificing their lives through extraordinary acts of kindness. I mean, they had literally become the most stunningly different kinds of people that the world had ever seen, and the empire took note. I mean, Julian was actually concerned that they were winning too many Romans to this new Jesus way of living. I want to actually read you part of one of Julian's directives to his pagan priests, where he pretty much implores them to go out and try to outlove the Christians. He writes this, "Why do we not observe that it is their benevolence to strangers, their care for the graves of the dead and pretended holiness of their lives that have done the most to increase atheism?" All right, quick side note. When he says increasing atheism, he's talking about the fact that the Romans were forsaking all the Roman pagan gods and opting for Jesus instead. And thus he says atheism was on the rise. Glorious. Now, back to Julian, he continues, "I believe that we ought to truly practice every one of these virtues, for it is disgraceful that when the impious Galileans or Christians support not only their own poor, but ours as well, all men will see that our people lack aid from us." Julian was basically telling his priests that these Christians, they were turning his empire and the world upside down by living incredibly different and questionable lives. As this new kind of community, I mean, they were feeding their poor as a community. They were welcoming the lonely and the stranger, regardless of their status. They were embracing the immigrant and the slave. They had quite literally created an alternative kingdom in the midst of that one, and it was creating an insatiable curiosity among the average Roman. Apparently, this is what it looked like to live a questionable kind of way as a church community, roughly, I don't know, 1700 years ago. And so our challenge is to ask, what does this look like in our day and in our time? What kind of church community would evoke the same sort of response? What would raise eyebrows from the perceived power brokers? What would intrigue the average American to want to know why? What would create curiosity? What would amaze? Because it's not necessarily expected or predictable. You could say, yeah, it's different. You know, we can think about this on an individual level, sure. But this has always really been about what we do together and how we live this whole thing out together. And so then it becomes like why is your community so forgiving and accepting when everyone else, yeah, they pick sides and hold grudges? Or why are you people so generous when the world is so scarce? And why are you so hopeful and joyful when there's so much pain? Why are you so different? And then let's take this a step closer to home. And let's think about this corporately in terms of the vision that God is birthing in us as a church about our dream of creating a different kind of space for the community called the Vineyard Co-Gather. Because this is our response, our missional response to the days and the times in which we live. This is our answer to the loneliness and the disconnection and the brokenness of our community. And we know it's well, different. And we know that some are going to find this highly questionable. Some will wonder, why? I mean, why would you do a capital campaign to create something that will likely be used more for the community than for your church? That's questionable. Why not do a campaign to, I don't know, buy a church building someday? And while there's nothing inherently wrong with that, it's just kind of highly predictable. It's expected. And honestly, it's not likely to evoke many questions from the community. So we're doing it differently. And we're seeking to create this alternative kind of space for an alternative kind of community, living an alternative kind of way that we believe is going to arouse the curiosity of others and ultimately show the overwhelming goodness of the kingdom of God. A place that will be a blessing and a gift to the community, a place where we can live out our values of generosity and hospitality and compassion day by day, hour by hour, which brings me to talking about habits and where we're going to take this for the rest of the summer. Because if we're truly going to be these different kinds of people living questionable lives together as a church community, a community that embraces the values of the kingdom of God, then as I said earlier, we've got to nurture, we've got to foster these values through what we do and the choices we make. It's not enough just to say we value generosity and hospitality and compassion if it's not seen by the way we actually live. Because remember what amazed the crowds? What gave Jesus such authority? It was that he was actually living what he taught. And so if we want to be a certain type of church who values certain types of things, then it seems that we need to foster habits that are going to shape those values. Earlier this week, you received a video of me promoting this series while exercising on a rowing machine, complete with unmatching headband and wristbands. You know, my whole life, I've valued health and fitness. I've valued leading an active lifestyle. And for years, that value, it's been fostered. It's been nurtured by getting up early and going to that gym and getting on that rowing machine to work out early in the morning. But back in March 2020, my gym shut down. So I quit going. I quit working out. I got out of the habit. And so for the past 6 months or so, I've been saying to myself on almost a daily basis, you should really get back into exercising again. You should go back to the gym. It's something you value. It's something that's good for you. Now, I guess I could have tried to engage the value of health and fitness by buying and reading a vast array of health and fitness magazines to learn about the benefits of that kind of lifestyle. But I knew what I really needed to do. I needed to get up before 6 a.m. I needed to get on that rowing machine and I needed to do the stuff. It was going to take action and I knew it. It was going to have to become a habit again. Whatever they say, it takes 30 days or so to form a habit. I think I'm on about day 27 of going back to the gym, so I'm almost there. Well, starting next week, we're going to begin talking about some spiritual habits that we believe are going to nurture the values of the kingdom of God that we want to see as a community, or maybe think of them as spiritual practices that will lead to these alternative ways of living that we believe are going to arouse the curiosity of our community. And so we're going to be exploring a handful of habits that we just believe they're going to alert others to the reality of what Jesus said when he was asked about his kingdom. Because when he was asked by those same religious leaders to show them the kingdom of God, here's what Jesus said. He said, "It's impossible to say, here it is or there it is, because the kingdom of God, it's in your midst." And you know, that's our heart's desire for you individually and for our church corporately, that we would experience the kingdom of God among us, in our midst, as we embody the values of the kingdom in all sorts of questionable kinds of ways. And so I warn you, this is going to be highly practical, with opportunities abounding for you to actually get on the rowing machine and nurture those values. So be ready. It's time once again to row the boat. Which reminds me, get to one of our local branches this Sunday. This is where we row the boat together. This is where we're working out all this stuff in all sorts of glorious ways. And so if you've missed the boat, or you've neglected the boat, or ignored the boat, or if you thought the boat sank, it may be time to get back on and grab an oar, because we need you. This community needs you. And so we hope to see you there. All right, until then, grace and peace to you, my friends.